December 14th, 2015, Community Planning and Development Commission. First up on the agenda is a public hearing for the planned residential development at 149 Norden Street, or Van Norden. So Nick, if you wouldn't mind reading the legal notice?
Notice is hereby given under section 4.4 and section 11.2.3.3.5 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. The Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, December 14th, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to consider the preliminary plans for a two-dwelling planned residential development general, PRDG, submitted by Jesse and Sarah Wilson for the property located at 149 Van Norden Road, Assessor's Map 39, Lot 212. This has been rescheduled from December 7th, 2015. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Department in Town Hall Monday through Thursday from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
So this is how we'll handle the public hearing. We'll give staff an opportunity to introduce the project, give the applicant an opportunity to present. The board can then ask our questions and deliberate. We'll open up to public input, close the public hearing, and then hopefully finalize the paperwork. So, Julie.
Essentially, 149 Van Norden Road is an oversized lot in the S20 zoning district. It's a property that's nestled in the northwest quadrant of town. The owners, the Wilsons, they don't have enough frontage to do a regular A&R process to create two lots. So instead, they put together a proof plan based on the underlying zoning, proving that they can get a yield of two lots. But instead of doing a standard subdivision, they've come forward with this PRD. That basically minimizes the amount of impervious, and it's a more, you know, quaint, sort of friendly development style. And they've gone to town meeting and gotten it approved, and now they're here tonight with a preliminary plan, and they're seeking your approval. After this, if they get approved, they'll come back with a final plan.
Okay, great.
Basically, so that's what we're here for right now.
Excellent. Thank you. All right, Brad. Take it away.
My name is Brad Latham. I'm here with Jesse and Sarah Wilson, who are the applicants, and with Jack Sullivan, who's going to make the main portion of the presentation. As the planner indicated, director indicated, the background, I won't repeat that. I'd like to jump to a couple of points, though, that are relevant to your decision. As was indicated, the objective is to divide this property into two lots. The common area or open space that's required as part of the planned residential development, or PRD, is really going to be part of Lot 2. But it would be imposed with an easement for the benefit of Lot 1. There'd be a homeowners association to assure that it stays open in a natural condition. And that would be, we'll give you details on that, of course, in the actual homeowners association documents as part of the definitive file. There's no need for common signage. That's another issue that you look at. And these would be really just two homes with two driveways. There'd be no significant impact. Just adding one home to the street is adequate sight distance in that area. Just going some of the dimensional requirements. The zoning requires that you have a 60,000 square foot lot to be able to have a PRD. As you've heard, it's over 2 acres. It's well in excess of what's required. The frontage, you have to have 50 feet per lot. Here, it's in excess of that. One has about 140. The other has 60. Floor area ratio is also very favorable. Maximum is 0.4. This has 0.044. As far as building coverage, maximum building coverage allowed by the zoning is 25%. This has 4%. Open space requirement must be 40% minimum. This has over 50%. The common area is also fairly significant, including wetlands. It's well over an acre, 52,000 some odd square feet. Uplands is just about an acre that's involved. The final point I'd like to walk through quickly deals with the elements that you looked at in your decision, and then Jack can give you the details. This is a suitable location, consistent with the neighborhood. It's all single-family dwellings. That's what the proposal is here as well. Also, the use is consistent with the S-20 district. It's an attractive dwelling that will be placed there. It'll certainly not create a nuisance. It won't be inconvenience or hazardous to abutters. It'll be safe to still access because each dwelling has its own driveway. There's no confluent problems there. There's no need for off-site loading, of course, if this is residential in character. The disposal of sewage, water supply, electricity are all adequate and available. It's not, the dwelling would not be in a flood hazard area. I described earlier, we'll present a homeowners association for you and an open space management plan as part of the definitive filing. So that's our overview, and I'd ask if Jack would continue on with your particulars of this design.
Thanks, Brad. For the record, my name is Jack Sullivan. I'm owner of the Sullivan Engineering Group. And I just want to add a few particulars to the site design and why we think this is a good development. As you can see, towards the rear corner of the lot, there's a bordering vegetated wetland. There's also a certified vernal pool in that area. To let the commission know, we went before the Conservation Commission about a week ago. We've submitted an NRAD application with them, which basically establishes the wetland line. That was approved. There were a couple flags that were changed. They were moved uplands, flags 5, 6, and 7. They moved about 15 feet in an upland direction. A new plan has been submitted to conservation, and hopefully when we get to a definitive filing for this, the approved wetland line will be shown. What's important to note is in the discussion I had with the Conservation Commission as well, is the intent all along was to have no work within 100 feet of a wetland. Even with the adjusted wetland line, we'll still be outside of 100 feet from any wetland, any vernal pool. And part of this development, with this type of open space development, is you want to try to retain natural site features. There's a hill area here behind where the proposed house will go. That'll be retained. All this wooded area to the rear will be retained, and there'll be no work within 100 feet of the wetlands. What we also try to do with the existing house, which I think everyone knows, but Jesse's grandmother, who's in her 90s, lives in this house here. So the way this all developed is they'd like to live next door to the grandparents. How could that be done? There wasn't enough frontage for the two A&R lots, as Julie stated. We could do a conventional subdivision. That wasn't really the way to go. It would be expensive putting the road in and would destroy the lot. So I know you guys haven't seen too many PRD developments, but that's how this came about. And the idea is we basically left a conforming lot. As Brad said, it'll be part of the homeowners association with Jesse and Sarah's lot as well. But basically, I tried to leave the existing lot conforming. It has sufficient frontage, sufficient area, just as any of the other existing conforming homes on the street would have. I should note that I did locate, as part of the survey, I located trees at the site entrance. So for the new driveway entrance, there'll be no town trees that need to be cut. We showed the existing trees would be retained. And the idea with the driveway is the clearing of the wooded area would only be for the driveway itself. They'd like to leave as much privacy between them and the grandmother, and also between them and John Grayson, who lives next door. What they're trying to do at this stage, we'll have more detailed plans, but they're basically looking to build a cape here with a two-car garage. For stormwater treatment, I'm proposing a low-impact design of porous pavement. I did do two soil test holes. They were witnessed by the engineering department, so we know what type of soils we're dealing with. We know where the groundwater table is. And as you can see, they're really looking to just have a minimum yard area. The limit of work line's here, so there'll be a small, you know, rear yard. There'll be a side yard. They do have two children, so they want some lawn area for the kids to play. And as Brad stated, each house will have separate utilities, separate water, sewer, electrical. We can run underground electrical to the house if that's something CPDC would like to see. I'm thinking they would. So we're basically trying to work with the existing site, limit the amount of any sort of tree clearing, and as I stated way back when we went to town meeting, if forced, I could have tried to develop this as a 3-lot subdivision. My proof plan shows a 2-lot subdivision. I think if I worked hard enough, I could have got 3.
That was not the intention all along. It was just to get one additional lot for Jesse and Sarah to build their house and let their family grow up in Reading. Jesse grew up in Reading, so he'd like to come back. I'll turn it over for any questions the CPC might have.
Any questions? I'm happy to hear that the Conservation Commission has already seen this. I know that, I think, if memory serves, that was kind of a hot topic during town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
So that's good that you did that in that order.
It went fine.
Good. Thank you. And you're not proposing any changes to the existing dwelling? Did I understand that correctly? Or?
We're not proposing any changes to the existing dwelling. The intent, the grandmother still lives there. She's
yeah.
living there. The house, there's a pool, there's a shed / garage, all that's staying as is.
Got it. Okay. Anybody else? How about anyone from the public have any questions or comments? Close the public hearing.
Move that the CPDC close the public hearing for the planned residential development at 149 Van Norden Road.
Second. All those in favor? All right. So are we, do we have a draft decision?
Mm-hmm.
And this is just a preliminary
correct.
Approval?
It's a preliminary plan approval, yeah. And two things I'll note before you delve into the conditions. I need to update the list of plans on the front to reflect the revised dates.
Yeah.
I noticed earlier tonight that they're not correct. And then I do have the order of conditions from the Conservation Commission, and it would be good to reference this as a condition.
Yeah.
As Jack noted, because there were some changes to the wetland flags.
Thank you.
Were there any changes in the draft decision versus the packets that got mailed to us?
Sorry, can you say that?
No.
Since the packet went out?
It's the same as what was in
no.
the packet.
Okay.
And it's what's in front of you as well.
Yeah.
So there is already a condition, Jack, about utilities being underground.
Okay.
So that's
I think you're better off, because if you're not going to clear a lot of trees, you know, you're going to lose some branches at some point and then take it down.
I reviewed the decision and found it in good order.
Yeah.
Is there anything we need to fill in?
I don't think so.
Gene, this is a special permit, right?
This is a planned residential development decision.
Okay. Is there anything extra we need to do? Because it references the special permit.
Well, I think this is really just the preliminary phase, so they'll appear again for the final.
Okay.
And I think at that point we probably fully get into that.
Move that the CPDC approve the preliminary plan review for the planned residential development at 149 Van Norden Road.
Second.
Thank you, good.
No, I was just checking the date. Do you have a date issue? You prepared these in 14?
It should be right here, Vic.
I'm just looking at this.
I have this date, October 3rd. unless there was a revision made.
The site plan is prepared by Sullivan Engineering Group dated February 17th, 2014. Is that a real date?
It's not correct.
Okay, so we're going to correct that
yeah.
to October 3rd, 2015?
Yeah.
And you're going to plug in the dates for the other items. So I'd offer that as a friendly amendment.
Yep.
Anything else, man? Karen?
I'm good.
All those in favor?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good plan.
Yeah.
Yeah,
the work you did really helped.
That was easy. That was easy, yeah, I know. Yeah. We've got 10 minutes until the next public hearing is scheduled to begin. So why don't we take this opportunity to introduce and meet our new Community Services Director.
Community Development Director.
Yep. Community Development Director, Julie Mercier. So Julie, if you wouldn't mind just introducing yourself.
Yeah, no, that's great. So my name is Julie Mercier. I guess as far as like background in planning goes, I have a bachelor's degree in planning, and I worked when I graduated for 3.5 years in the state of New Jersey as a planning consultant. And then I moved up to Boston and worked for an architecture firm for a year. And then I worked for the town of Concord for 4.5 years before going back to school. And I just graduated in May. And I worked for part-time for a developer while I was in school. And then this opportunity came up and I thought it seemed great. So here I am.
Good, good. Welcome.
Thank you.
Our Jean is ecstatic, delighted. Yeah, there's no shortage of work going on right now in this town, so.
Gonna hire the marching band to welcome.
Excellent. I trust Jean has filled you in on us.
Not so much. There hasn't been a lot of time, actually.
Yeah, when did you start?
This is my third Monday.
Oh, yeah, okay. That's right, I heard three.
I started right after Thanksgiving.
Got it. Good, good, good.
So you worked in Concord. Are you from? Did you grow up in Massachusetts?
I did.
Are you from this
I'm
area? Are you from?
No, I'm originally from the Berkshires, actually. Yeah, and but I've lived since I moved back up here after college and after working in New Jersey. I've lived in the Boston area for about 8 years, and worked in Concord for 4.5. Yeah, and now I live in Arlington. I'm fairly local.
Yeah.
Well, welcome. Any questions for Julie? All right.
Any questions for us?
No, not right now.
We'll have plenty of time.
We'll come.
Yeah.
All right. Well, we still have a few minutes. Do we want to take some of the planning updates and other topics right now? Tackle that?
Sure.
Do you want to tackle the minutes?
We could do minutes, yeah.
Yeah, minutes probably a good way.
Now we need to correct the second sentence of the first A&R, first page. It says two surveyors worked on the plan and the need to amend the plot line on the western side. What we're trying to say there, or and there is a need.
Discovered the need.
Yeah, something like that. Economic development paragraph. Sixth sentence down, it says, draft The draft included six strategies to developing each piece of land. Is it really land or is it area? Because you're talking about areas in the entire paragraph. I didn't think it was one specific piece.
Yeah, they're priority development areas.
Areas, yeah, so each area.
And Mr. Safina noted this is a good proactive plan, but asked, is there a plan? Or words to that effect? CPDC approved the minutes for the meeting of November 23rd, 2015 as amended.
Yes, I do. All those in favor? Aye, and one abstain. All right.
Four zero one.
So we got 5 minutes. Anything else we can? There you go. Perfect.
Please spend a few minutes talking about zoning for 2016.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm imagining that we would want an update on the zoning project at annual town meeting, and like we did last year, and then begin planning as early as January for subsequent town meeting in November. I think that's sort of the path we followed last year, more or less. There's been a lot of discussion through the economic development plan about expanding the downtown 40R district. And so that was one of the strategies, recommendations that came out of that economic development plan. So to begin maybe having some public hearings, some neighborhood meetings, some discussion in the community about you know, where those lines might be for expansion. I think one of the things we talked about through that whole planning process was crossing over the railroad tracks where the Doucette building is, and that area where, which is now slated for 40B, but to continue to pursue expanding that 40R district into that area. And then there's been, you know, the plan calls for going out as far as Washington Street, High Street, Washington Street, Main Street. And we'll probably want to have a fair amount of discussion about that. Likewise, there's been some interest expressed to me about expanding the district out into Woburn Street, some portions of Woburn Street. So that's certainly something we could put on the agenda for discussion. Like I say, no time like January to get started on zoning.
We started working pretty heavy on, with George's help, on some other sections of the bylaw. Who's that?
PUD? PUD and PRD. Yeah, the application that you just reviewed and approved We've done some research on deep lot zoning, and it really seems like the process for the PRD that the Wilsons just went through and will continue to come back at, it's a bit cumbersome. And we think that with some models that we've looked at for deep lot zoning, we can probably get to what we're trying to achieve, which is preserving the open space component, that rear portion of the lot, and then doing a nice friendly development by adding another house and making it look like kind of what this process ends up delivering, but in a much more efficient way. I mean, they had to go to town meeting. Now they're coming back for a preliminary plan, then they'll have to go back for a final plan. It seems like a lot for just one house.
Yeah, absolutely.
So the PRD is definitely something, and as I say, it, something different that would, because we have a lot of those deep lots. And so, like I say, we've got some research that might be helpful.
Mm-hmm.
And then we talked about PUD, looking at that.
So I think what George had come up with when we were talking about that was changing PUD to be a certain thing, what it almost is what it are already, but making sure that we don't leave a gap
mm-hmm.
for situations like what's going on right now without jumping through, having to go through
sure.
all that administrative. So I think that's the reason why we wanted to look at those two things
yeah.
together. So if there's a better way to address what's being addressed through PRD, then maybe
right.
not, yeah. But I think the two have to be looked at
yeah.
together to make sure that we're not creating some gap with someone that wants to do something that should have been
sure.
allowed to do something but just can't because the threshold is wrong.
Yeah.
Well, for sure, we don't want to create a situation where the only way to go forward would be a 40B, for example.
Right.
Right.
Yeah, we want to be able to do favorable development.
Right. I mean, we've kind of set an expectation with town meeting of what we were going to look at next, and I mean, if that changes, that's fine, especially given the economic development plan
mm-hmm.
that we've been working, that the town's been working on. So let's take a look at those items for an early meeting in January and figure out which ones we want to pursue and
mm-hmm.
which ones we want to throw in the back burner. I'm assuming signs is still probably a little too dicey.
Yep. And then there's parking, which is another
yep.
long-term goal.
Okay.
Go away with it. Hover cars. Stack them up.
All right. Any questions on that? Is that what you wanted to cover with that, Gene?
Yep.
Okay, good. All right, well, it's 8:02, so good. We can start our next public hearing. So next up on the agenda is a public hearing for site plan review, 258-262 Main Street. So, Nick, you can read the public notice.
Notice is hereby given under Section 4.3 and Section 4.6 of the Reading Zoning Bylaw. Community Planning and Development Commission will hold a public hearing on Monday, December 14th, 2015 at 8 p.m. in the Selectmen's Meeting Room at Reading Town Hall, 16 Lowell Street, to hear the site plan review application from Reading CRE Ventures LLC for the property located at 258-262 Main Street, Assessor's Map 11, Lot 193 and 194. Applicant is proposing to demolish two existing buildings and construct a new 15,600 square foot, four-story, multi-tenant building with associated parking and site improvements. A copy of the application and associated plans are available to the public in the Public Services Department in Town Hall Monday through Thursday, 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m. and Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m.
All right, thank you. So this is how we'll handle the public hearing. We'll first have Julie introduce the project, then we'll give the applicant an opportunity to present. The board will deliberate, discuss the project, and then we'll open it up to public input, couple public questions. Please just wait to be called on before you start speaking. Then we'll close the public hearing and work on any paperwork that needs to be filed. So with that, Julie.
Thanks.
Take it away.
Okay, so the site, 258 to 262 Main Street, currently is two lots that you drive past when you're on 28 South, heading out of town. It's the applicant is proposing to consolidate the two lots and demolish both structures, I believe. Currently, I received a memo today, actually, and I think it was in your packet, from the Historical Commission, that a demolition delay has been imposed on the site, so they will not be able to demolish the building for 6 months. The site has a paper street on its eastern edge. Yeah, that's perfect. What they're proposing to do is, it's about a 30,000 square foot lot when they're combined, and they're proposing to put about a 15,000 square foot four-story multi-tenant office building in the space with 52 parking spaces. The 52 parking spaces are broken up into two parking lots that do not actually connect to each other. So there will be two different two-way curb cuts coming off of Route 28 South into the site. That's, in a nutshell, the proposal that's before you right now.
Yeah. Great, thank you. Please.
Thank you. Chris Latham for the applicant, running CRE Ventures LLC. As well as engineer Ian Rubin and architect Joe Luna. For the commission's reference, this project was specifically designed in accordance with the South Main Street design guidelines, which resulted in the placement of the proposed structure in the center and toward the front of the property with parking on the sides and the rear. In addition, this project was designed consistent with the July 8th DRT and informal CPDC comments from July 8th, 2013. The CPDC had suggested on July 18th, 2013, that the applicant consider contacting abutting commercial properties for shared or additional parking. And that resulted in us, our client, getting into a contract to purchase 262 Main Street, which is on the north side of the lot, to provide additional parking. The applicant's property at 258 Main Street is substantially located in the Business A District. A portion of the rear of the property at 258 Main Street is located in the S15 Zoning District. 262, the northern lot, is completely located in the Business A Zoning District. The applicant proposes to remove the two existing buildings, excavate down to street level, because right now the property is elevated, and construct a 14,851 square foot gross floor area, four-story commercial building for retail, consumer use, and office uses. And so there's no residential. I know that there was some people that were concerned that there were residential uses proposed here. There are no residential uses proposed in this project. The building will be handicap accessible with ramps and as well as an elevator. The proposed building will be encompassed by a walkway, which will connect directly into the public sidewalk out front. As well as in the parking lot. The building's HVAC mechanicals will be located on the roof of the new building. There will be a bike rack that will be provided at the front, but of course if the board wants us to put it somewhere else, we're willing to move it to wherever you guys would like it. There's a total of 15 parking spaces. DRT had requested that we remove a couple parking spaces, so we remove one at the front of the property. That one's actually, I think that that one in the November 2nd, I think, plan shows that parking spot actually being removed. Ian, do you mind?
Do you want to pull the site plan up?
This is, sorry. No, I haven't. I'm just
there may have been two removed.
Oh,
there's one at the front that one removed. You can see this is not quite the same size.
Oh, it was called site plan on the site. But no, you're probably right.
So there are two dual direct parking lot access driveways as depicted on the plans. And they're substantially in the same locations as the two existing parking lot access driveways that currently serve the existing structure.
Excuse me, Chris, what plan should we be calling up?
It should be the November 2nd.
A plan sheet number you can refer us to?
The one that was labeled site plan final is the landscaping plan.
And do you remember what your plan was?
The date on this? This is the November 2nd plan.
Yeah, we want to pull it up so that the people at home can see which plan we're talking about.
You don't have it there. The site plan.
No, that's not.
If you go back and look at the site plan final, that's the old one.
Yeah.
Somehow the new one didn't come through.
Okay.
Bring up the packet that you sent us.
I think everything we sent you is here.
Yeah, that's what we have.
Yeah. That's not the same as what we sent.
So
the plan is different than what you're projecting.
Yeah.
This is the one that wants to be. Yes, yeah. It's the hard copy one that was submitted. I don't know what happened with the electronic ones, but.
Okay, why don't you work off of the board and we'll go into the Google Drive.
So if you want to discuss that, let me just finish our the plan shows two dual directional parking lot access driveways, which are substantially in the same location as the two existing access ways. There is a loading zone that is provided under the building along the southerly side of the building. That's what the gap is. This has not changed. This is where the access is, and the loading zone is in under the building. With that said, if the board would like to waive loading zones, we're fine with that too. There's a proposed solid wood fence and block retaining walls that are proposed along the abutting residential properties on the Pineville side. And a dumpster is depicted in the far corner, further southern corner, over here. And that would be enclosed with a fence as well. And the board may recall when we were here before this board in 2013, the dumpster was placed over there, so it'd be away from the residences, and that's what we've done. Snow storage would be behind. Basically off the parking area where you basically see the two squares for the tables in the back. That's basically where the snow storage would be and some of that green space there. And so with that being said, I'll turn it over to Ian and Joe, however you'd like to present. Joe's an architect, Ian's the engineer.
Okay.
Existing condition plan, which is this one right here.
Can you move that down here?
Yep, I can do that.
Thank you.
Sorry. That's still a little bit of a problem in the light, so.
Fit it on.
Hey, Gene.
Is it okay for him to put that there? Is it okay for him to put that there? Or is that
I'm trying to call it up on the email, so just bear with me.
People at home, do they see that, or do they see an image electronically? They
see the projection.
The actual projection.
Let's give it a second. See if Gene can pull it up.
Pressure. Now you see all my emails, so.
Stand on your.
Still file sitting as something else.
Let me go back into my.
Yep.
You just save it out to your desktop.
And then you can rotate it.
And then you can probably rotate it because it's read only right now.
Go back to the file, right click it, and you should be able to save it. Close out.
No.
Just drag it from the desktop, drag it from the email to your desktop.
I created this file.
Yeah, it's 95 seconds. Minimize that, drag it out.
Yep, save it.
To just address one issue that I just want to briefly state here is that on this plan, which is the existing conditions, you can see this is where the paved surface is and it goes to the way back of the property. So with the development, we are bringing that forward. The end of the development is right there and creating green space at the back. Also, with this development, this is like a knoll over here. It's high ground. This building is situated somewhat high up on that. This one's a little lower because the driveway is lower down, but this is high up. So what we've done with this development is cut back from back here. You can see this is coming down to allow the building to be at street level. Also, by cutting it down, there is it creates a lower portion back here which collects all the runoff, saving it from draining onto the street. So there's far less water draining onto the street than in current conditions. Basically, I think just briefly what I want to mention too is that all the utilities are underground. And then the changes that we've made on this plan after the review from the technical review, we have taken out two parking spaces up front. So the front corner parking spaces are removed. What that has allowed us to do is to put the bike rack up front instead of the back. And the purpose of that is it becomes available for people passing by to see that there's a bike rack. And then the third thing we did was changed this little sidewalk here. Before it was a little longer to avoid handrails. with the slope of this, we'd have to have handrails. That's the only difference. So that's basically the only changes in the plan that was made. So we've reduced the number of parking spaces by 2. That does not change the footage of the building. If we reduce it anymore, the footage would have to be reduced. And I don't want to go into any technical issues here, but if there are any questions on that, I'll answer that. I think that's where I'll leave it for now.
For the record, my name is Joseph Luna, L-U-N-A. His name is Luna DeFranco for the architects, and we're based out of Denver. Before we pull up the architectural plan, I just want to talk just in terms of how the building is sited, because there is some deliberate thought about that as well. You can see the parking is basically consolidated on the sides and the rear. We did not want the building to have, or the site, to have a sea of parking along Main Street. So the building is deliberately pushed forward so it presents a street presence along Main Street. So what we have are two lots, as we know, and the parking, the main entry into the building is in the back. That's the main entrance into the office building. And then we have the loading area, and then we'll have retail entries potentially. And this all is dependent on the tenant, off of either the front and the side. So we're looking at this as having multiple points of entries, but the primary entry into the building is going to be at the back, and that's going to be servicing the office building. But again, one of the things that was important is that we did not want to see a sea of parking along the front facade here, so the building is pulled forward. The other thing it does is provides more distance from the back to the residential district. Can we get to the architectural drawings, please?
I'm a little concerned that they might all be the old ones.
Okay, we'll start at A1, we'll basically just work ourselves up through the building.
And now have these plans changed?
No, the plans are the same that was presented at the November meeting. What we have is we have a four-story building, but we have a small sub-basement, and we'll spend a lot of time. There is no tenant area down here. The only thing we'll be providing is the elevator machine room, some mechanical space, but it's primarily just serving, and one egress there. It's just holding some mechanical space within the building. Can we go to the next plan up? That occupies roughly 376 square feet, so it's a very small area. This is the main floor on the ground level. What you'll see is there's a one vehicle loading bay on the left side of the plan here. As I mentioned, the back of the site is here. Our primary entrance here will be a vestibule, a small elevator lobby, and two egress stairs. And then we have the rentable floor area with potential for two tenants. As I mentioned before, the entries, there could be potential entries in this, but it'll all be dependent on the tenant. But it is set up so these tenants can have independent entries of each other. Parking lot side here, street side, and parking lot side. Next. This is floors 2 and 3. The core of the office building is pushed toward the back of the building here. We'll have our toilet facilities, again, whatever we need for mechanical closets, electrical closets, etc., and the two egress stairs, a lit lobby, when I say lit, with natural daylight, it's not an internal core. And the space is designed so we can maximize the utility of this, where it can either be one large tenant, two tenants split down the middle, or three individual tenants. So the plan is designed to be as efficient as possible in terms of how the number of tenants can be laid out inside the space. Next slide, please. The fourth floor is a partial floor. This is the perimeter of the building, keep the area down, but also to reduce the presence along the street. You'll see that the floor is a much smaller footprint in terms of the rentable area. Thus, back and floor gets smaller, but the stairs and elevators have to remain the same because it still needs two means of egress and the elevator. There will be some type of deck structure around the perimeter of this. This is still further in development. We don't know how many tenants will actually go in this, but it'll either be one or two tenants because it's a relatively small area. The upper floor is only 2,500 square feet. Thanks a lot. Let's not go to those because you're just looking at a roof plan, which I think is exciting. Let's go to A200. All right, the facade of the building. This is the parking lot side. The rear entry that you're seeing is the primary entrance. What you're looking at here are the stair towers. This is the facade along Main Street. Our height is at 45 feet to the top of the primary roof line. There are some mechanical screens here on just at the stairs, but in talking with the building department, he felt that these were still in conformance with zoning because it's not the primary roof line and these aren't serving any Cuban offset and only used for the stairs. There'll be a signage panel along the bottom. It's basically a tripartite scheme where you have a base, a shaft, and a cap. Same along the back. Let's go to the last slide to give you a better understanding of what the, it's right there. These are some prospective studies we did of the building. Again, the Main Street side is here. You can see how the fourth floor is set back along the roof line. It's our intent to have this be a light structure on the bottom where we have supporting columns and a plinth with glass infill, and then a more solid material along the front and the side. Now, regarding what these materials are, we're using a cement fiberboard and combination of different materials. This does not represent a final color scheme. I want to be clear on that. These are using a panelized system that we can. We're introducing three different colors here. Basically, two in the same hue, and then an accent color along that. These colors can be any color that we want from a Benjamin Moore or Sherwin Williams color. We're using a product, a cement fiber product made by a company called Nichiha. The dark side you see on the side elevations is actually using this type of material. Just pass around for you. It's quite heavy. Be careful with your fingers. And it comes in a variation. It's a simulated wood material. And then the multicolored panels is a smooth panel. And again, these can be done in whatever color we decide. I'll pass along some brochure information. You can get some other examples of how this material looks. There'll be metal windows. These will not be operable except for the doorways inside here. The cabinet equipment for the entire building will be located up on the fourth floor roof. This is the elevator. Those are our two stairs. And then decorative, whatever type we want for signage, building identification, et cetera, on the building. We are trying to do a building that looks like an office commercial building. I know there's been a lot of discussions about the historical significance of the house. It was not our intent to make an overinflated structure to look like an overinflated house. We want this building to look as its use group. The design of this is actually a series of architecturally floating planes that are coming off that, with each plane having a different surface articulation where they intersect. So what you're seeing there is, when you get a good example of the shadow line inside that, if this is a plane, that's a plane, and where they intersect, there's always a reveal break. So it's a series of these different material planes that come and intersect, sitting on top of a more lighter structure on the base. Going up Main Street, we all know that there's a sort of a smorgasbord of different types of architectural styles and scale inside there.
You're very polite.
I was told to be. but what we're trying to do is, again, we're using some classical elements in terms of at least a tripartite scheme where we have a base, a shaft, and a cap. Although we're not using wood because what we have to do for codes, we are using some kind of simulated that will give the texture of a clapboard siding on that. But along the front, we're making more of a statement that, again, gives the building a signature. And it's being used only in limited capacity. We're along the front and these two stair towers. The rest of the building will be clad in the wood, simulated wood clapboard siding that you see right there. And that's basically an overview of the building. If any committee has any questions, or we can hold that for public comment.
We'll start with questions in a minute.
Okay. That's the overview of the building. Thank you.
So, Gene, I guess I'm going to look to you, or maybe Julie, because there's a document in our packet starting on page 8 that has just an overview of findings that staff has.
Yeah, that's the planner's memo.
Do we want to start with that and go through those items, or do we want to? And maybe I'll look to the board. Does that make sense? Start with those items, and then we can open it up to a broader conversation.
These are not CRT comments. This is just staff comments.
Right.
Which is probably more recent, right? Because the DRT is when.
It's October.
Yeah.
DRT
comments are also in
there. And the comments from the town engineer that we
got today.
Okay. Any concerns with that approach? So the first item is the exact size of the building needs clarification. It looks like there's a couple of figures that have either been provided or have been kind of calculated. So can it be confirmed what the square footage of the building is? That is the official.
Right, and I can give you the breakdown of the areas per floor. The basement is 376 square feet. The first floor is 3,546 square feet. The second and third floors are identical in their square footage, 4,241 square feet. The fourth floor is 2,447 square feet for a total of 14,851 square feet.
All right. And then if you do the calculation, that lands you at 52 parking spaces, right? Based on what's in our bylaw?
49.5 rounded to 50.
Okay. And that's what you have now with the changes that you recently made? 50?
Yeah,
okay.
If I have a typo, you say 9 spaces on the north of the building.
I was looking at the wrong plan. Okay, I'm just clarifying that some of the comments in here are based on my review of the incorrect plan. Oh, okay. Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so 50 total spaces. And then the next comment is, staff recommends eliminating the 4 spaces closest to the street. So can we just point those out, which ones you were specifically calling out?
Let's go back to our...
Yeah. I'm looking for that image.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. This one was just looking at, yep.
Yeah.
Do you want some clarification on that?
Well, I just want to know which spaces they were referring to.
Either side of the curb.
And one of them has been removed on this plan.
Two of them have been removed.
Two of?
Right. Yeah. They were over here and here.
Do that again?
They were in here originally and in here originally.
Okay. But we still have these two here, which run up right onto the edge of the road, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
We have close to, eyeballing it here, about 20 feet from the traveled way to the first parking space because of the radius of the curves there. So if a car is pulling in and another car is pulling out, they wouldn't be out in on Route 28.
Mm.
Which is really what the concern is,
mm-hmm.
what we've seen. So eliminate, I don't know what it looked like before, but to me, it looks like there's, you know, sort of enough space here
between the traveled way of 28 and the spaces as they're laid out here to give, you know, enough.
Okay.
I mean, obviously, it would be better if there was a little bit more, but it's not,
sure.
I don't think it's crazy. You see,
okay.
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 The next bit of feedback is just a concern about the fire department, and they will need to verify that the proposed emergency access is acceptable. And then also we've requested radii templates for fire department apparatus. So I assume that fire was at the DRT, or were they not?
They were.
Okay. But this plan is somewhat different than what was reviewed in that meeting, so we would need their input.
I think we just want to use that as a placeholder to make sure they're okay with whatever
okay.
the final plan is.
Okay, so that we can have a condition or something there. The next one, a one-way in-out circulation pattern with angled parking would allow a connection between the parking lots, as well as a reduction in pavement width and the possibility for landscape buffering on the north and south property lines. So any additional color you want to provide on that one? Are you thinking kind of move the building over?
Slightly. I had done some like rough calculations and figured that with a one-way ingress egress, it could actually loop around the building and you could have angled parking.
Oh, I see.
And sort of bring it all in a little tighter.
Yeah, I was curious about that myself because the, I guess it's the north, the corner, the notch, if you will, in the property line. You're regrading so that there isn't a elevation difference between the north parking lot and the rear parking lot. I mean, so that you could basically put a driveway.
You certainly could put a driveway through. The only reason we haven't is because it reduces the number of parking spaces substantially, and hence the size of the building.
Well, depending on the availability of waivers or interpretation, if you calculate parking based on the net floor area instead of the gross floor area, then you end up with the DRT answer of a much lower number of required spaces, or in 34, something like that, spaces, which would give you the flexibility, I believe, to do that, the one-way circulation, and would also probably make the fire chief happier because he'd be able to
drive through
and reach all portions of the building.
Roughly a quarter of the floor area is given to just core elements, the stairs, the elevator, the halls,
right.
Yeah.
Which are not, they factor into a lease, but they're not actual occupiable areas.
Right. That's basically, the zoning bylaw has the separate definition for net floor area, floor area net.
Right, but your
which
parking goes by GSF.
Currently, yes.
Yeah,
that's our problem.
We can figure something out. I mean, it sounds like you may have already kind of explored this based on a comment you just made, right?
Look at every opportunity there is.
I thought there was a note from the fire chief that he didn't want that reduced. Start moving the building south,
you're going to cut into that left, the southmost driveway. And even with the angle parking, the spaces don't get that much shallower, if at all. I don't think they do at all.
If you do angular parking and you do one way, you need no more than 15 feet wide. So that immediately, you don't have 20 feet anymore.
That's a problem. The fire chief said he needs 20 feet.
I thought I saw that one.
20.
Of these
he did say that.
Okay. 20
well,
feet is pretty tough. He's not turning around in that back lot. He's going to have to back out and make a multiple point turn.
Right.
So
right.
If he's okay with that, that's fine. But I think the bigger issue is getting the cars off of 28 quickly. We don't want our bagel issue.
Right.
Cars stacking up because that first spot's open, so someone stops and tries to get into that, waits for the other car to come out. Now they're on 28. So really, if we can get the cars off of the road as fast as possible so that's wider curb cut. Rather than say narrow one way, I don't know if that works. I don't know that the solution is to move it over and try to get a drive around lane.
Just to widen the curb cut to allow for.
Well.
No, I don't know about widening it. I don't know that angular parking, moving the building south to try and get the drive to go all the way through, makes it any better. And you probably lose 5 spots, maybe 5 or 6.
Okay, well, let's see. According to sheet 3, basically from the property line to the corner of the building is 24.4. So you wouldn't have to move the building necessarily to get the connection from the north lot into the rear lot.
I can provide some clarification on the dead area.
Well, one second, I think, let's kind of think through this.
Well, I mean, that's a retaining wall, so you have to hope that they hit it exactly right. I don't know how close I want. This is actually a walkway, isn't it? I don't know how close I'd want cars coming to the corner of my building. But maybe. I think you'd have to overlay the vehicle movements, especially the fire apparatus, on that to make sure it works. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's at least 5 spaces.
It's good.
It's tight.
It's good to change this.
Yeah. I think we need that in order to.
It would help with emptying the smaller lot.
What was that?
It would help with the smaller lot because people are going to come in here and then have to make weird maneuvers to get back out.
Right.
If it's full.
Right.
I would try to make it work without moving the building.
Right.
What other options have you looked at as far as the parking lot layout goes?
Well, we've put the building to one side entirely or to the other side, just to try and, you know, instead of having parking on both sides, we've tried there. You end up with a smaller building. I mean, that's kind of what it amounts to. And as far as my understanding is, you know, to make this financially feasible, they really want this size building. Now, if we can reduce the number of parking spaces without losing the size of the building and going by net floor area, if that is exactly what the zoning implies, which I don't know, then we can reconsider the layout of the parking, absolutely.
By leasable floor area, because I have the actual calculation on the drawings for leasable floor area, which is exclusive of the core element and the sub-basement, the total floor area goes from 14,000, over 14,000, down to 10,205 square feet.
Mm-hmm.
You're looking at the ground floor, and I can give you these numbers right now, of rentable floor area of 3,417. That currently has the vehicle loading bay cut inside that. Floors, floors 2 and 3 would be 3,193 square feet per usable floor area. And then the upper floor area is only 405 square feet.
Right.
So these are relatively small, leasable floor areas. Elevators don't change regardless. Stair sizes have to be because of the floor height and what's required for the minimum stair dimensions. Plus bathroom and all floors have to have handicap accessible bathrooms, which take up more floor area. So, you know, you're looking at about a quarter of the footprint on each floor going just to basic core elements that have to go into the building. You're talking, you know, just over 10,000 square feet of actual rentable floor area on that, which was, if you count calculate the parking based on that usable area, which has dramatically reduced the number of parking spaces, and possibly allow for that drive aisle to connect two lots.
But the bylaws don't let us.
The bylaws state different.
Don't let us do that.
Well, you can't do it without suitable approval, right?
Right.
A variance.
So we took obviously by the letter of the bylaws and based the site design on trying to get meet the requirements for the parking spaces, drive aisle, the loading area, et cetera, et cetera. As you can see, it's a lot of effort, and I think how the project is sited with the parking lot is particularly serving both retail. I showed you the floor plan on
right.
entries on that. Pushing it to one side really starts compromising how the building works, which I think is a very efficient design.
Mm-hmm.
Another thing I would request the board to keep in mind is that the zoning bylaws allow for 60% lot coverage of the structure. This is only 15.4%.
Even if you lost six spaces, you'd be 10 over the amount for net square footage. Net square footage, the way David was talking, is 34 spaces. You need 50. If you lost six spaces, you'd be at 44. Somewhere right in the middle.
Right, and what we could do at that point is, in order to get the commercial, loading area, we had to, and still keep the parking, we had to bring that into the building. We could then take that out of the building, put it outside because it doesn't require a dock, it only requires a loading area. Give a little bit of area back into the retail area and then use some of those additional spaces to meet the loading requirements.
You're
going to
increase your net area if you do that.
Not enough, but we can do that, sir. I think we could juggle that.
Well, I mean, I don't know where we want to go with this. I mean, I like the building, I like the plan.
I'd like to evaluate how we can get the parking lot right now, I think, is my biggest area of heartache.
Yeah.
No, your site plan doesn't match your floor plan for where that curb cut is to the loading dock. Right? Am I reading that right?
Right. There's a slight difference on where, if that's what you're saying, as to where you enter the building.
This is the loading area?
That's the loading area.
It's on the south side?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this sort of shows it centered.
More or less in the middle.
I think it's more.
Yeah.
You think it's in the middle?
On the site plan, it shows up more or less in the middle.
But it's more north. It's
more
north.
You're right.
Yeah. Okay. But that point of entry is valuable. At least in the site plan. Not on the architecture.
Yeah.
No, it's fine on that side. Let's keep it away from the residential edges.
Yes.
I know that the fire department only offered comments only on a previous plan. Was that similar to this? And the reason why I'm asking is my recollection of comments that they've provided on other projects have really tried to keep them from having to turn their vehicles around, especially when the buildings are more than two stories.
Yep.
Or so. So I'm forget about circulation of people and cars. One thing that we, what we won't waver on is making sure that the fire department has what they need. I see they offered the comment about the 20-foot drive aisle, but did they offer any comment, or can you recall what they require typically for circulation for a building, something like this? Because it doesn't seem to me that, I think that's the bigger issue in terms of site layout than the six spaces that
right.
we might be able to shuffle around.
Yeah, it's interesting that they made a point of saying no less than 20 feet on the drive aisle. That's what they said at the DRT, and that's what's in the DRT notes. I think it was in the context of how challenging it's going to be to get in and out of that site for a truck. if you improve the circulation, there may be an opportunity to revisit that.
So I guess what I'm getting at is I think we need to look at the really what's get comments from the fire department on this and not just take a comment. I'm going to say it's not out of context,
right.
But it was pointed to something directly because there might be a little bit of more flexibility.
Yep.
There may be some other concerns that they come up with that you need to incorporate into the design changes. I wouldn't want you to go too far down one road and then have comments from them that sort of.
So the first step is to find out what the fire department really want, what they will accept, and take it from there.
I would suggest that, because that's the, from what I'm looking at here, I don't know, guys, maybe I'm off base here, but it seems like I would have thought they'd have more comments than just keep it at,
mm-hmm.
At 20 feet, because they typically would have more comments than that on this.
Okay. That's it?
Yeah.
That's the way next step.
Yeah.
Okay, let's keep going through this list. So curb cuts will require Mass DOT approval. And in addition, as the driveways are proposed less than 125 feet apart, a waiver from the Board of Selectmen will be required.
Okay, I was a little bit confused about that because they're both the existing curb cuts and existing driveways. So I'm not sure. I mean, we certainly need to get compliance or from DOT, but we're not adding anything. In fact, the plan would result in reducing the size of the existing access, I believe.
But there are two boards that there are two approving authorities, one being state MassDOT
mm-hmm.
for the curb cuts, and the other being the Board of Selectmen because they don't meet the standard of the width. 125 feet.
Board of Selectmen has jurisdiction on 28.
They have a policy or a Board of Selectmen rule that says you have to meet that standard. I mean, it's obviously under the jurisdiction of MassDOT for 28, but I think town-wide, the Board of Selectmen has that authority as the roadway commissioners.
Yeah, I was just curious as to what grandfather provisions there might be on those two things.
I think MassDOT would look at this as a new application.
I have the selectman's policy, if I may, on what we're talking about. And the truth of the matter is the policy itself is pretty ambiguous. It has a contradiction in and of itself. So the contradiction is what Jean is referencing, I believe, is F on the first page. And what we've been designing for is G. And G refers to a parking lot, which we thought was applicable to this situation. So there's a difference of 50 feet versus 125 feet. And I know back in the day when the town, the Board of Selectmen initially adopted this, they were trying to basically do a one-size-fit-all. They were basically taking residential and commercial and lumping it together. This is obviously a policy. It's not a bylaw. So it doesn't have the force and effect per se as a bylaw does. But there is definitely a contradiction in between F and G in their own policy. Likewise, on page two, it references not more than two driveways for any one property. So, when we were designing this, when William was designing this, we were looking at G and two relative to that. So.
Mm-hmm.
that. I don't know if we're going to resolve that necessarily tonight.
Oh, no, I didn't. I just wanted the board to be aware of
no,
the
that's
fact
good.
That the policy itself is
thank you for pointing that out.
There.
But okay, so let's, we'll need to discuss that further and get
the resolution.
Particularly
unless you assume F and G are two different things. One, you know, drive access and parking lots.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I mean, this one interprets, we're talking about dual direction with the way it's been designed versus sort of silent on something,
Let's keep moving. The next topic is around the loading zone. CPDC may want to condition approval noting the limitations of the size of delivery trucks, and maybe we want to consider waiving the requirement altogether. I don't know about that, but I mean, is there any idea on what kind of tenants you may have in here and what types of delivery trucks you would expect?
Well, the size of the zoning bay is 35 by 15.
Right.
And that's in the bylaws. So it's a 32-foot vehicle.
Yeah, it's a limit.
With enough room to load on the sides,
right? So
we'll
need to limit it to that size.
Yeah.
We don't want a tractor trailer in the middle of.
No,
but you're talking like a WB Mason truck or a FedEx or UPS truck, that type. That, again, it's a professional office building with a small amount of retail. You're not going to have tractor trailers coming in and out of that building.
Right.
Again, it's only just over 10,000 square feet of usable floor area. So.
Got it. Yep. So we'll want to condition that, though. Make sure
it really does depend on that retail tenant, though.
Yeah.
Nobody
right.
delivers food in anything smaller than a tractor trailer.
Yep.
Yeah.
Even
coffee
the pizza shops.
Tractor trailer.
You'd be surprised how many delivery companies, furniture delivery companies, freight companies will pull up and into it, regardless of what you tell them.
Yeah.
So if we are looking for a waiver for one of the spots, I think we have to protect this lot from the Dunkin' Donuts disaster, you know, at the Shell station there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Then we have the bike rack. Recommend locating the bike rack. I think you guys said you were pretty agreeable to moving it wherever.
Mm-hmm.
So landscaping and lighting. Have we received a plan on that? Has there been a landscape plan submitted?
We did submit a landscaping plan on the revised edition. Elaborate a little bit more on what was already there, a little bit more detail.
I think a lot of the feedback in this section goes to the perimeter, ensuring that there's no light spillage into the abutters, homes, or the streets, things like that. Site plan indicates 8 mature trees are to be removed and requesting a new landscape plan be prepared. Wood fence detail was presented.
Mm-hmm.
And that was received favorably by staff.
But that was added to the revised plan.
Okay.
Now just for future reference, this particular property, there's some amount of existing screening between the proposed site and the adjacent site. So it would be sort of nice if we had at least an approximate current condition of the adjoining property. How many big trees are next to it? You know, because it's not clear, I mean, driving past it on the way to this meeting, it's not clear which lot the
trees are on.
Trees are on.
There are trees next door.
Yeah.
Okay.
photometric and the renderings.
Where are the eight trees that are going to be?
Well, maybe, I mean, if we could pull it up.
Pull up the existing one?
Yeah.
They're right now, they're in between the two houses.
Oh, okay.
So.
Travel agency, yeah.
Yeah, some next to the travel agency.
Okay.
I should love it. Click on the building itself.
Yep.
So while we're doing this, I think my guess is a lot of people in the room here tonight are abutters, and I think one of their biggest concerns is the fact that we've got pretty much what was a resident, two residences, more or less, pretty low use plots now being repurposed for a pretty big commercial project. And the need for screening is going to be a very important topic that we're going to need to get right here. Otherwise, we're going to be back here with these poor people are going to have to be dealing with a lot of frustration. So that's something we're definitely going to want to understand and make sure we're all clear on. That's next to parking. That's my biggest concern.
At the same time, what we're comparing it to is a currently an underutilized, if vacant building.
Right.
That's used seasonally for commercial purposes. As in right now, it's the selling Christmas trees has been for a while. So it's not an incompatible use. But comparing active use to a vacant building, I mean, there's always going to be a concern.
Absolutely.
I think we should just remember that we do have a large existing parking lot on that property.
Yes.
So I would assume it was used for commercial space at some point.
Sure, you're right.
It actually hasn't, to my knowledge, 258 hasn't been used for a single family residential use for
decades.
As long as I was alive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You know?
At least 50 years.
Oh, at least 50 years. I've been there.
Mm-hmm.
I think it would be good if you could spot some elevations for the top of that structure versus yours, because you're taking a whole story, you're coming down a whole story, you're not that much higher than this, but I think it's important for everybody to understand this relative to your new building, so they can see what that is. Because the appearance from Main Street is going to be of a three-story building with your setback.
Yes.
From the other side, you are a four-story building,
but
you're coming down one whole story, pretty much. You're going from what looks like 104 to 99. So that building might be at 134, the top of that roof, and yours is 150, I think.
but I'm not sure, so.
We're a hole along the front facade here. We're going to be right around pretty much what you're looking at right there.
To the third floor, top of the third floor.
Right to the E1.
Right, but there's a story above that.
Right. But set so, back. Set back from the
yeah, no, I think from Main Street it's fine. I think it's great for Main Street. But I think it'd be good to have the actual elevations, spots, right? Because you're going to start your finished floor at 99, elevation 99.
Right.
But the existing one looks like it starts at 104.
Right. And add 35 to that,
right.
You end up about the same.
Right. So I'm trying to make it
right.
So that the abutters and everybody else who's got a concern can see the height of your building compared to what's there now. And it'll either, hopefully it'll appease them, but you know, if they have more of a concern, then we can have a talking point. Right now, they don't know where that building looks like.
Yeah, it'll be very easy to shoot it straight to the ridge of the roof.
And then on that same note, the way that I read this is, so you're going to have a six, maybe I am reading this wrong. Some retaining wall along the edge of the parking lot. How high is that?
Anything from 0 to 5 feet maximum. And it's going to only be 5 feet in the small area.
Okay, so let's call it 3 to 4 feet. And then a 6-foot fence on top of that. So I guess the point there being that, and it doesn't really come through in these plans because it's just a line, but you will, in essence, have screening around a 10-foot high screening around the sides, at least the sides of the lot, and then, as you mentioned, in the back, it's you're getting rid of the parking lot anyways, it's there.
Right, and we're providing trees along the sides at the back to provide some screening at an angle.
Sure. So it's hard to understand that for most people from a set of plans, and that's really one of the biggest issues is that impact to abutters because of the change of use.
Also, I'm curious. We've got the paper street, the Star Road, in the back. What's the condition there? Do we know, Jean?
The paper street?
Yeah. Is that just?
Yeah, it's just
town land or?
Well. The paper street is basically just what's back there. I mean, it's never been used, or I don't think it's an actual street. I think it's just overgrown.
I believe it's owned to the center line by the abutters, but it's undeveloped. It's not. That's why it's called paper street. It's just on paper.
Okay.
Not in
I
real life.
If you want to see what it looks like, I mean, it's full
sure.
Foliage.
You could also pull up the Google Earth.
No, I mean, I think our only concern is that it's never used as an access point for this lot.
Right there, so
that's
it has no improvements to it, so it's
okay.
No potential
no
for access. That's what I'd be concerned
about. Okay. I was curious because I noticed on the larger scale map that there's a fairly substantial landlocked area back there with this. Perfectly happy to leave it that way.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
So far we've hit on, I think, three primary areas of focus. One is parking, to ensure we get the fire department's feedback. Adequate screenage, and then Nick's point about making sure we understand the height of the building in relation to the existing structure. I know we got a memo, I don't think I've even read it yet, from the town engineer with a number of findings. I don't think we need to go through that here.
No.
Have you guys seen
that yet? So
you haven't? Okay.
No.
Okay.
Can't prove 5:30.
Oh, okay. I got you. What other, from the board, what other feedback, comments, concerns, questions do we have?
And the lighting plans are nice, that this is a good visualization, but remember too that there's lighting on the building, or I don't know what you plan on doing up on that upper deck, but if you're gonna put some packs on that.
It hasn't been developed yet.
All right, as long as we're not looking up at a bunch of lights, or that's separate, any part of the building, and then, I know we're not
talking about 400-plus square foot area up there, so it's not gonna accommodate any major use up there that's gonna have an outdoor deck. It's a small area.
No, but it should be used. I mean,
right.
Don't put it there if you're not gonna use it.
Oh, we do wanna use it.
And then the other piece, which we're probably not looking at just yet, is a master signage plan. One thing I think that's important for a building that looks like this, and I like the look of this building, but that master signage plan has to be set. And a lot of times we approve master signage plans, and then some tenant comes by, and they want to bypass the master signage plan because they have a specific idea for what they want for their sign. They know best. But really, I think that'll ruin the unity of the architecture of this building if you just have a whole bunch of random signs.
No, the intent, if you go back to the facade drawings, we'll go to the massing studies. The A4. That one there.
Yeah, okay.
You can see there's a freeze board, essentially. I mean, it's a more industrial looking, but there's a freeze that the tenant side has to be mounted on. So the idea on it is to keep a consistent sort of datum where the signs attach onto this freeze.
I think it needs to be more than that.
Yeah.
Just went by a building, I'm trying to remember where it was, and so I think it's between here and Woonsocket. So all of the signs are exactly the same, right? So I think it was all white lettering in that case for that building. It was appropriate. It wasn't, this is the freeze board, and you get to put your sign of any color, you know, with any kind of text on it, on the freeze board. I think it's just not going to work.
No,
I think
completely agree. That's why you see all the tenant.
Right.
Tenant
and that's fine, too, except that's way too big. If you're going to have Commonwealth Marketing come in, they're not going to have a 50-foot long sign. So you'll have to set the limits for where they fit.
Right.
And it has to be within that.
You can see we're also trying to, what we're doing, just in terms of the building identification, is just trying to pull in some of those elements of that freeze up here, and then you can see over here on the back.
Yeah, that's fine. I think if it's lit right, it'll be fine. I just think it needs to be almost the way you're showing it, in that they're all the same. That's good enough, really.
We can limit to 7 other tenants.
Yes.
No, but I mean, bear in mind, it is a small, very nice commercial building, so we don't want very large commercial signs on it.
Yes.
How many rooftop units do you envision on here?
It's going to be dependent on what we're going to get for tenants, but there'll probably be 2 RTUs per floor, so you're looking at 6 to 8 units. We're not, and again, there'll be rooftop units. We're not putting a cooling tower.
About snow removal. I saw a little bit in there about that.
On site?
It's in the back where the basically being pushed off the parking lot onto the green space. We're showing the plans with the tables, the picnic tables in the back.
Okay.
That'd be the snow storage.
So it would end up eating up a few parking spaces potentially?
Well, when you initially remove it, but
yeah.
Eventually when you push it, it will be pushed off the parking spots.
Any other questions from the board?
Where do you put your locate transformer and stuff
there? Good question. Location of transformer.
At this point, we're not sure that we need 3-phase electricity, in which case we don't need a transformer pad.
We will need 3-phase electricity.
And I think RMLD made a comment about that in the DRT notes.
Okay, well, we can add that. So
yeah, we'll want to see that.
Yeah.
think you referenced like photograph on that, in terms of the historic building. So how big are we talking here in terms of a transformer? What would you estimate for size of the transformer? I mean, are we talking like a big picture that we're talking about on this thing? Or
potentially there might be enough room to stick it on this little plant.
Yeah.
I would prefer not to have it along the front.
Not the front.
Right, so you're really only looking at these two legitimate areas that you can get it. You're going
to
be
shorten your runs to the elevator.
Yeah.
Or wherever your electrical run is.
Yeah, so, but it will require, it is an elevator, it's going to require three-phase power.
Yeah, so I think your island is probably the better location.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
There.
Or the other one.
Yeah, it's like the...
Oh, that island's going to go away. So don't even...
Well, I mean, basically, you're talking about the transformer at the corner of Bunratty's and the
yep.
main parking lot there. That's the scale of the thing you have to deal with.
In the courtyard.
Yeah. It requires, access management around it and so forth. So it's not a gigantic thing. It's like the size of this, half of this table is the area that you need.
So are we saying we want to see it located on the site plan and maybe some sort of a detail on it?
Right.
Yeah, we'll do a best guess size on it, but ultimately,
RMLD will tell you.
You should be able to get, I think the new folks probably have some specs on one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good?
Yep.
Yeah. Nick, Karen, Dave?
Yep. For the town engineer's memo.
The bottom of the disk packet.
With respect to these site elements that we're talking about, transformers and access and parking, is it a fair assessment that maybe a study based on the number of parking spaces on the current net area would be something to present on this as well?
I don't know if this board has that jurisdiction.
I don't know either.
Site plan review.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What?
That's building inspector.
Well,
yeah.
It would be good to see the benefit of the reduction. Because we got adjacent to it immediately on the south is another large parking area.
I think if, just my own opinion, if you could work something out for shared parking within the context of the bylaw, there's some flexibility built into it that way.
Right.
Maybe that's another approach because the bylaw is the bylaw. The site plan review jurisdiction, in my opinion, is limited to the things that it's limited to, which is
right.
not to, in some cases, CPDC can waive parking. I'm not sure in this case they can.
Right. It's, but the travel agency next door on the south, you might be able to arrange a shared parking arrangement because what you're talking about primarily is employee parking.
Yeah.
In the commercial building where you could do that probably on a favorable basis.
We could try. I believe my client already tried that route back between 2013 when we came before the board before and 2014. We can give it another shot. It didn't work last time.
But you were probably looking for 20 spaces, right? Because that's before you had the other property. Now you're only looking for
I don't really remember because we had some underneath too. You know what I mean?
Right.
That previous design had parking beneath it. So, but we'll try to revisit it.
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, if we can not try to get 50 spaces, that frees up more area for drive aisles, additional landscaping, comfortable transformer pad locations,
right?
Yeah.
And all the various stuff we have to put on this site. But we're again, because we're only talking just over 10,000 square feet of usable rentable area inside this. We still are trying to make the project financially viable, that it's a commercially viable project.
And we agree with you 100% on that.
Okay. So there's also some place, I assume, that you some at least minimum number of spaces that you need in order to make it financially viable as well in order to be able to.
Right, that you're providing adequate off-street parking for the tenants that are renting the space.
Right, and I, you all know better what that, where that is, somewhere less than 50 and more than 40.
More than 20, whatever.
Yeah, I don't know.
Nick, Karen? All right, let's open it up to any public comments or questions. Sir?
Can we?
Oh, I'm sorry, if you wouldn't mind just stating your name.
Mike Farrell, 2 Pinevale.
Sure.
Can we swing this over so we can look at Pinevale, please? No, go to the south.
Am I going the wrong way?
You're getting there.
Yeah.
Keep going, please.
To the south?
Look south.
Click and drag it.
Oh, I see.
Can we get a look down this driveway?
Oh, sure. Okay.
There you go.
See, once you flatten this down, there's already a wall here. I've already got a fence here. I'm concerned that it's not tall enough to maintain the security. It's all right the way it is now because we've got all of these trees. You take this down, you've got that tall building, and I've got a concern with the top of the building. I'm losing a lot of privacy. Can we go back to A4? There's doors on the top, 1, 2, I'm assuming on the other side.
Yes.
So up here, they're going to go out and there's going to be a walkway
this
around
this facade
there.
Here would be facing your property on that direction.
Yes, it would be. So that would be over here.
Yes.
So there would be people up on the top looking over. I've got concerns with that. A general comment is I'm concerned this is going to affect negatively my property value.
I think most of the residents...
Would you mind just your name and... address?
My name is Liu and Zhang, and we are living on Pinevale as well. And our concern is about the same. I think this building will really let some of the residents on the street lose the privacy, especially with all the glass windows on the back. And it's just, yeah.
The balcony.
Yeah, in the balcony, yeah.
Okay.
And.
Okay. I think understanding the screening, something we spoke about, we're going to really want to understand that.
Mm-hmm.
As we kind of anticipated, that's going to definitely be a hot area of concern. Yes?
Hi. Kind of the same as far as...
Oh, I'm sorry. Name.
Oh, Aaron Hickey, and I live at 25 Pinevale. My concern, I don't know if you can go back to one where the driveways are going into the property.
Google Earth.
Sure. That would be good.
Going into the property?
Yeah, to try and visualize, because there's two, right?
Right. So one approximately what you're looking at right there.
Right there?
And yes. And then come back around.
Yeah.
They're not all that dissimilar.
Okay, so right. Just kind of, yeah.
Right. So our building is kind of right in.
All right. So a concern is definitely just kind of going back to the parking spaces as well topic. People getting in and out. And then creating a backup on 28, which then cars will then back up possibly far enough to be blocking Pinevale, and residents trying to get in and out during the day, morning during rush hour, can be hard to get on to Main Street. And we already kind of see, sorry to bring up bagel world in the car wash, but it's bad.
Mm-hmm.
So, and not knowing what type of tenants are going in there, overflow parking, is it gonna end up possibly being on Pinevale? Which I see on every morning at Starbucks.
Mm-hmm.
On that, I can't think of the name of the street right there that
mm-hmm.
is alongside Starbucks.
Mm-hmm. Across from Avon, yeah. Up by Bell's.
Yeah.
So, one thing that's probably worth a discussion is sort of the how trips work, and that in the sense that. Because a building is bigger doesn't necessarily mean that there's more car trips that are generated each day.
You all know how offices work. People come in the morning, maybe at lunchtime. Well, probably at lunchtime they leave, unless there's some good restaurants around in walking distance. And then in the afternoon they leave. All the cars depart, which is a different scenario than, let's say, five Bagel Worlds stacked on top of each other that have, you know, all of that traffic generation. So the odd thing here is we don't, no one knows what that, I'm assuming it's just first floor. Did you say first floor retail?
Yes.
Yeah, so what that first floor retail is, it could be something so benign that it doesn't really generate much traffic, that you just don't see that. Or it could be, Dunkin' Donuts, that I'm not saying that it's going to be Dunkin' Donuts, but Dunkin' Donuts is the type of thing that generates a lot of traffic. And so until we get to, it's sort of hard to, I'm agreeing with you that it's hard to understand what that traffic generation is. But the fact that it's, that there's offices on top of that typically doesn't mean that much more. It's really, it's all about that first floor retail. So if this site were developed as a single story building, that is as likely to have as much traffic as if as a four story building with three stories of office. So I just sort of laying that out in terms of how to think about how this site gets developed.
I mean, one thing, and I can't promise that there'll never be a commercial food establishment, but a tenant like a Dunkin' Donuts, a tenant like a Starbucks is gonna want drive through and queuing areas.
You ain't gonna get it.
Yeah, you're not gonna get it on this site, so it doesn't make this site commercially viable for that type of use. You're looking more of a professional, like, you know, a dental office, or that type of retail professional office space than an establishment like a food vendor, because the site doesn't warrant that. People want to be able to go in and out. That's how we're putting all this together. So I think, although I can't say it would never happen, this is not a site that's going to be conducive to any type of company that's going to want to have that ability to do those things. It just isn't there. So it's going to define the type of tenants are going to have a use for that, which is basically a walk-in type of space off of a parking area.
And also, right, you know how you're going to build that space out. It's different for a restaurant tenant than it is for
an Aspen Dental type of thing.
In terms of the utilities that you put in there, right? I mean, we experienced that here in town where they didn't plan accordingly. It didn't quite work out well. So.
Dan?
Tina Brzezinski, 60 Terrace Park. A couple things I wanted to say. One is I actually think it's an excellent reuse of property. I think what's there now is an eyesore, and the idea of bringing it down to street level is excellent. The second thing I want to say, though, is I think the parking is inadequate. Generally, the rule of thumb is 200 to 250 square feet per parking space. So that would bring the parking to be more in line for 60. I know the town regulations are slightly different. It's one per 300. But realistically, so anytime you're thinking about reducing parking in any way, that raises a red flag. So, the idea of moving the building or knocking out five parking spaces is a problem. And we know parking studies been done in Reading. There's supposedly adequate parking if everyone allows other people to use their spaces, but that simply doesn't happen. And where this building is located, you're not really going to have people walking from the T to this building. So I just want to suggest that the board seriously consider making sure that there is adequate parking for the building relative to what is required per zoning. And then I don't think, you know, suggesting that they reduce spaces or receive a variance for something like that is appropriate. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Just going back to the building and the lack of privacy, the lighting is another concern. We haven't seen the plans. We don't know how it is.
I think we have lighting plans in here.
Photometric study.
Yeah.
One of those.
We'll need to make sure you
can see those.
You may have that in the initial package, the back. Yep, the photometric study, right. And there's more perspectives, I believe, on that too, going down the 30 days.
That would be lit up at night, all through the night, in the parking lot?
It's a property management issue. I can't answer that question. How it would be, normally it would be set on top of a timer.
Yeah, we would have a timer. Probably work out what the appropriate hours are for the lights. Yeah. So no, it wouldn't be on all night?
No. And obviously there would not be any lights up at the upper part of the building. And this is only this only shows what we're doing for parking lot lighting. And obviously when it's nighttime and this time of year, you're gonna have light just coming out of the building at nighttime and until the building basically closes down for the evening.
I know we're running out of space on the northwest edges to do screening, but you might have the opportunity to put the landscape screening on the abutting properties to offer it to those landowners, then they control the screen. So a new owner for this building couldn't come in and cut down that tree.
Well, that would be my house, and there is no room in the back.
I know on yours, it's really tight.
It's
looking at the two properties that are immediately up in the corner, the Meduno properties.
There's already trees there.
Yeah, I'm not sure how dense they are. But if the wall and the fence were inadequate, some trees up along that edge on the other property side might help to fill in.
The northeast corner is my concern.
I'm sorry?
The northeast corner is my concern. There's already a brick wall and there's already a fence there. And it's not going to be tall enough for the building.
Well, it's not tall enough for the house next to it either.
It pretty well cuts it off. When you sit in the kitchen, you can't see.
I know, but somebody could build a two-story house there and they'd be over here.
I don't think they'd get zoned for it, would they?
I'm sorry?
Very small lot.
Somebody could build a two-story building there, 35 feet high, and it would be over your fence line. I'm not trying to say that your privacy concerns aren't valid. I'm just trying to make a point that at some point, there's just no way to screen your abutter. But potentially, we can start to fill in these edges if they get too thin. You can do it from both sides of the line. That's all I'm saying. Your property looks tight. We'll have to look at that.
Extremely tight.
Also, it looks like
the trees would have to go in the parking lot.
Yeah, that's going to be tough. I don't think they can do that there. The rear side, the west side, will look like a service corridor, if you will. So the concerns for the windows on the back side of the building, they're really sort of unoccupied spaces.
Yes. Let's go back to the master check. A24,
So this brown block in the middle here in the lower.
That's your core element. That you're coming in here, your elevator lobby. So this is not going to be any type of leasable tenant space inside that. That we just want to get light into that lobby area. These are the stair towers, which again are not going to be occupied. So there really isn't anyone looking out. You're looking out toward the front and toward the sides in terms of this office. The leasable space is confined just in that area. Everything along the back here is your core elements.
What about if you did some sort of vertical vanes on that north window wall so that the views actually come back out towards the street?
Well, you can see one of the things we are
not there
doing here, articulating that we could
that
sort of make those as, like you said, some kind of vane here that would direct towards different location.
So Farrell, do you understand what we're talking about there? So if we had that sort of
a louver. Imagine just taking a louver like a blind instead of doing it horizontally, turning it vertically.
That would address my concern, thank you.
Right. Mm-hmm. And so it's a series of louvers.
Yeah, and I don't think it impacts your
design. Right, and you can see the sort of architectural elements right here that we're introducing. There wouldn't be, and you can see it over along here as well. I mean, we've broken up the facade where there's sort of ribbon punch and we didn't want it just to make it look like a stacked, typical office building. So there's some articulation in terms of how we did the fenestration on this. But you can see those louvers, and we could actually tilt those as we need to.
Yeah, I think that would work.
Yeah,
I think that would help.
Yeah, and you've got also the, whatever it would be, 36, 50 feet worth of parking area between the side of the building and your property line. I mean, so it's not...
With the line of trees, it would be fine.
Any other questions?
How long will it take to build this building? Just curious.
Construction, say, roughly 10 months.
10 months?
10 months.
Okay.
I mean, it's going to be weather dependent. We have yet to get borings and find out what we're going to do for foundations. Foundations can go up in a month. Foundations can go up in 2 months.
Right.
The structure would be a steel frame structure with either steel bar joists or wood, depending on what we can get for the fire classifications inside that. It's a pretty basic light frame structure.
Mm-hmm.
The nice thing about the panels, you're not bringing in masons. It's all basically hung on a clip system, and it would actually go up pretty fast. And then that's for core and shell. Then depending on the tenants, that would be done as a turnover. You know,
right, the fit-in, right.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Any All right, well, do we need to review the feedback, make sure we're all on the same page, or?
I think we're on the same page.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, so we'll continue the public hearing until what would be the next opportunity?
It's our next meeting. It's
January 11th. 11th, okay.
Do you think you'll be ready, Chris?
Think you'll be ready?
Ian?
I don't know if you're ready.
Yeah.
You good?
You just follow what we give him.
So we'll have to talk about when we'll need everything, you know, given the December calendar.
Okay.
I think we would need everything really Monday the 4th at the latest.
Happy holidays, Ian.
Well, I mean, the big question is what the fire department
says.
Yeah.
And if they're happy with backing in and driving out on both sides, I would say we're pretty high and dry. But if not, we have to change the plan. And so I think the next step is to go to the fire chief, see what the story is, get a clear indication as to how they would like to see this, and if necessary, postpone the hearing.
So,
for the
try,
time being,
try and go for the 11th.
Try and go for the
11th.
Yeah.
If not, 25th, but we've got...
I don't think we can fit anything. We've got a big agenda on the 25th.
So it would be the 11th or whatever the first meeting in February is.
So be it, right?
Yeah, I mean, that's
what
it is, right?
You're
okay.
6 month demo delay already started, right?
Yeah, you got a
yeah.
demo delay, so.
Thursday, Friday.
So that's not impacted by when we held our hearings. They're in the demo delay, so they can't really do anything on site.
Right.
Unless
Christmas
they're going to be requesting an early delay, I don't know. An early release of the delays.
We're trying. We sent out letters today to various historical preservation organizations like Historic New England and Sturbridge Village and Strawberry Bank, and if anybody has any other suggestions, please let us know. But we sent out letters, so we're hoping.
Trying to find a home for the colonial structure, at least the front part of it. The building, I don't really touch on it tonight, but there's a lot of deterioration inside that building, and
mm-hmm.
you know, it's going to be a challenge to move it. Just, I mean, you could see right even at the eave line. At the main roof bearings, you can see just it's opening up.
Yeah.
Yep.
Right, and this is the can we go down the street a little bit? Looking at this, heading back to 128?
South.
Yeah. Go up.
More,
and then we'll look into the site. That whole porch is just rotting and falling apart. The additions that are back here, this area is actually opened up and is bringing water into the building right now. Go around the backside over here, the whole corner board, you could just basically stick your finger through. So if anything is going to be saved, it's going to be the primary structure. And, you know, it's one, if we could find, the first thing is, can we find a legitimate home for it?
Right.
We have told the Historic Commission that the pre-existing beehive ovens will work into an architectural feature within the building, lobby area, the focal point, if we can. But it's finding a home for the building. And as Council said, we're being out to call to find out if anybody wants a building.
Okay. Good enough. That's helpful. Thank you.
Move that we... The CPDC continue the public hearing for the proposed development at 258 262 Main Street until January 11th, 2016 at 7:30.
Second. All those in favor? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, please. Thank you, everybody.
Do you know what the date of the original building, the existing building?
I did. I don't have that off the top of my head.
Was it apparently early 1800s?
Yeah,
or?
Thereabouts. And went through a series of ownership transitions. And,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
You
know, I mean, I grew up in a house that looked much like that. But
have a record of who was here.
They would have ended up down there.
Samples.
Which
they
okay.
Your attorney has them. The samples?
Yeah,
they're right behind
Chris
your attorney.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
It's a nice building. In terms of the use, I don't know, what do you call it, the expected use, the 580 Main Street, the Bank of America building, which has the first floor retail, and it only has the one story of the extra commercial, but it's the same kind of usage characteristic. The Bank of America, you've got Christopher's, on the first floor. It's basically the sit-down cafe kind of thing, which would work.
Yeah. Parking. There's never a shortage of parking. There's just never enough parking.
Right.
Crystal ball.
We
yeah.
know.
All right.
Have a good holiday.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Have a good holiday. Thanks. We've got one more.
We're not done yet.
Yeah. Excuse me. Folks, we've got a couple more things to cover, so if you're not taking it, thank you. Sure.
Good idea. 5 minute adjournment, whatever.
Take five.
that was done for the prior to CALS versus the numbers that this place would sustain? Or even Bagel World.
They have a tenant base that they're targeting. They're just not telling us what it is.
I don't think it's food.
He's got to have a square footage study on that building.
Yeah, but I don't think it's food. I don't think it's food.
He's got to.
I didn't hear what you just said.
She's just suggesting that he already knows which tenants.
Oh, yeah.
He might know some of them, but I don't know that he has them all.
Well, you're a candidate, certainly.
Well, we've got one more item on our agenda. Discussion of applicant submission procedures.
Yeah, that's kind of something that I am trying to champion here. Because I noticed there's a lot of paper being used, and, you know, between the applicant giving us 14 full-size sets of everything, and then we mail them to you, and then we photocopy them again for you. I was wondering if there wasn't a way to sort of like reduce the staff's use of time and resources. If any of you are amenable to just having an electronic version available before the meeting and then a packet at the meeting, or if you'd be okay with a half-size plan versus a full-size, you know, if there's any flexibility in the current system, just to sort of use fewer resources.
Yeah.
Be a little more sustainable.
I'm fine with electronic. I think we'd need this, though, here, unless, do we get internet in here?
We do, well.
Is there Wi-Fi?
Did you get us all iPads or Surfaces?
Yeah, we were talking about that. What happened to that?
Deliver it that way.
That's definitely an option. It'd be nothing to grab some iPads. Well, easy for me to say. I could inquire about iPads. But I know, that's definitely an option. And then we would load them individually on the iPads. I know they do that in other, didn't you say that's how they did in Concord? Or?
No, actually,
no.
Concord's not technologically advanced at all.
North
but we
Reading.
Do double side.
Oh, that's good. That's
awesome.
North Reading, I know, does it that way.
I have a lot of commission clients that have that for their boards. They just got them iPads. They stopped printing.
Well,
I don't have a problem with. I think we had some of this discussion before. I'd prefer not to have full size sets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Tabloid is. I mean
the
11 by 17.
Yeah.
Is there anyone that wants a full-size set?
I mean, especially if you have, if we're, at some point we're getting electronic. If we have the 11 by 17s and we need the detail, then generally you can.
One issue, I mean,
I'll be honest, my problem with going completely electronic is sometimes it just, it's better now that we're doing the Google
Google Drive.
But before that, I don't know, sometimes stuff wouldn't work right. That means I need to be up to par on my IT. Everything needs to be working right. And you know what? Sometimes it isn't.
Yeah.
And so I hate to rely on that, but the Google Docs seem to, I've never been in an issue where that's been.
We could also do like Google Drive the Thursday before and then have your 11 by 17 copies here waiting for you for the meeting. Or, you know, there's different variations on this.
Well,
go ahead.
I have an issue with the electronic just because there's something about the way that the plans are stored on the Google Drive or in the Google Drive retriever, if you will. I can't make them big enough. I need to basically put it to full size and then be able to pan and examine the whole thing. I mean, because I've got old eyes. And there's something about the way either Chrome or Firefox, which are the two browsers I use, they give you one step of enlargement and that's it. You know, you don't have the full zoom capability, which is what I'd be looking for. I mean, if we had it as a I don't know if PDF gives you the capability or if there's some other, even, you know.
PDF, you can zoom in and out really as far as you want.
Yeah, I mean, this, because the, I love the electronic. It means I can pick it up while I'm, you know, having a coffee break at work, you know, that kind of, or at home. But I can't see the detail on some of the bigger things.
I think having paper copies here for us is important. I see a lot of these, all of us are sitting here taking notes or scribbling some suggestions, so that's important.
And have one or two extra perhaps for the, available for the audience. I'm not sure what the procedures are for that.
Yeah, so if we do a half size or even a tablet, it has to be to scale.
Right, yeah.
Don't make sure they don't just shrink
yeah,
it.
No.
Then I can't sketch.
Does that help?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah, that's good.
So look in iPads. That'd be kind of cool.
I mean, I was also thinking as far as like if we do mail you things home and then just remembering to bring them, I could set up an automated email that goes out to you on Sunday nights that reminds you, like, bring your stuff with you for the meeting tomorrow. If that's like something, if you're afraid you might forget something at home and then, you know, maybe it's not here.
There's, I'll put this out there. Sometimes I know for myself, I think I'll make it home before this meeting,
right.
But actually lately more often I'm coming straight from work here. So, and I, my stuff is sitting in my
right. So having it
having
here
something at least for one or
right.
two of
yeah.
us having a set
okay.
year for those that, you know, the day changes, it's probably important.
Yeah.
Yep.
If we go that route.
Okay. Yeah, we'll try to figure out a way to make it work. But
okay.
If we do switch plan size 11x17 to scale is okay with.
Yeah,
18
okay.
by 12.
Yeah.
I mean,
that would
12
at least
by 18. Either
what's
one.
That?
12 by 18 or 11 by 17. Either one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Not
okay.
this.
Yeah.
Seems
can't to
use
be
this.
A waste. But
yeah.
Time and money.
Well, thank you.
Anything else? Any updates to provide? So the wine store went out of business.
Wine stores closed. That you might remember, they came on. There's been several changes in ownership.
Yeah.
The last owner, who was an attorney, I guess there was some arrangement with this group a couple of years ago, and so I think that original owner is still involved to some degree.
Mm.
They couldn't make a go of it, this group. And, you know, it's a lot of things have changed in the last 6, 7, 8 years in terms of, you know, more competition and that.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the back 7 or 8 or 9 years ago, there were only a few places. Now there's just so many more. I mean, so many. So. Yeah, he didn't make it. And they embellish, you probably heard about that. They're going to be closing. So it's interesting that the new concept for hair salons is to go to, like what we saw with Sola Salon. It's a series of suites.
Right.
And so you're in a very small suite as a stylist with small overhead and you don't need a receptionist and can book appointments off your phone. And so it's kind of part of that shared economy. And so this one that's opening up in Stoneham, and a lot of them are going over there in Redstone.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It's called JD?
JC.
JC.
JD
yeah.
or JC, I forget which. I think it's JC. So that's another one that. And then the architects are going to be, they've started construction on the second and third floor of the M.F. Charles building.
Yeah.
So O'Sullivan Architects is moving in over there. So that building, was it 580 Main? The one with Christopher's?
Right.
That'll have some vacancies on the upper level.
Sola open?
Yeah.
I think they are, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah.
And I think Tropical Nails came for their occupancy
today.
Permit. Yeah. So One General Way is starting to get more active.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the, what is it, Reading Athletic Club is now Gold's Gym.
Gold's Gym, yeah.
That's huge.
Yeah.
That goes way deep into that building. See
yeah.
it when you come through on the train.
Yeah, I don't see much in the way of parking occupancy there. But so.
I don't think it's finished yet. I think they're building it still.
Oh, okay, because they had a banner out the front door.
Yeah, they're doing sales, I think, out of the front, very front
okay.
of it, but they're working back into it.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
The library over there is going great guns.
Perfectos. I mean, yeah, Perfectos.
I saw trucks there the other day.
Really?
Pickup trucks. But, and then the new owner of where eCars went, that's a new property owner. He's doing, I think he has an insurance business, so he'll have an office on the second floor. And he's doing, he's got a tenant for the first floor, which is physical therapy.
Hmm.
So.
And more parking than he could shake us.
I was thinking about that as we talked about parking tonight. He has no customer transactions with the activity he's doing up on the second floor. There's no people coming and going. So it'd be just the people coming for the physical therapy.
What if we had Bagel World people park there and we ran a shuttle? Bagel World drive-through.
What if we what if we take away Bagel World's drive-through permit?
That has to be fixed. That's crazy.
We have been talking a lot about that with the PTTTF, Parking Traffic Transportation Task Force, and the police have taken an active lead in working with the owner and seeing if they can come up with something. The statistics on crashes and complaints, and it's just completely off the charts.
Hmm.
Completely. So.
I don't know why people tolerate it. If I saw a line of car, keep going. I
yeah.
can't
well,
believe.
I do. I mean.
Are they that
the
good?
They're good bagels. But
they're really, really good bagels.
Bagels.
And I mean, if you can get them twice a year, you're doing well.
Unbelievable.
Great bagels. It's not worth listening to my husband for the next half an hour complaining. Waiting to get.
Oh, you got 2.5 an hour.
That's great. There on a Saturday afternoon, 3/4 of the people are your age.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right.
I couldn't even get by. I drove by Sunday
yeah.
at noontime, and they were stopped on both sides of the street trying to get in. I couldn't even pass by. And my mom was like, "Will you stop and get Bagel World?" And I was like, "No."
Yeah.
Is there a bigger space they can move to? Site.
Just got
Gold's Gym.
I know. It's just the location.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a real problem.
Anything with the post office or Walgreens?
Post office continues to have some discussion. You know, it's been 3-4 months that they've been trying to work through with the federal government. So, it seems serious.
Good.
Serious in a good way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Walgreens.
I haven't heard anything.
Mm.
Yeah.
Except that all their customer data went to CVS without the Walgreens customers knowing. Did you read that?
Yeah.
What was that?
What?
Like all their existing pharmacy customer data was like given to CVS.
Oh, yeah.
And the customers weren't informed. It was like a big, I mean, I think it was not just here.
No, I think
yeah.
it was like a bigger.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm. So we have a CVS and we have 2 Rite Aids.
Which Walgreens bought. So
I know.
Come back, so we'll end up having 2 Walgreens back in town.
You could have 3. Could have had 3.
Well, St. Agnes is starting to, the Paris
Building? Yeah.
The school. They were talking about trying to get before the Board of Selectmen in January, so.
For what?
Put possible friendly 40B.
Okay.
Units.
We'll encourage that.
If it's rental, it helps the town.
Yeah.
Right.
Get credit for all the units.
How many units were they looking at putting in there before?
Well, when we went in there, it was what?
23.
Was 20, yeah, 23 or 24.
Yeah.
The plan that was before us,
yeah.
Before.
And anything with the 40B at Doucette?
I haven't seen anything. Yeah, I even called the state. And they said it should be coming. They heard from them and would anticipate having a filing soon, filing for the special permit.
The discussion we had earlier about the zoning stuff, the expanding the 40R, when we originally talked about it, I've forgotten how many of us were involved in that. We planned to have the 40R cover the entire business B, excluding the piece of business B that's somewhere else. That's that.
Oh, REI.
Yeah. And there was a lot of pushback from town people about, and I've forgotten the name of the street on the other side of the railroad tracks.
Lincoln.
Lincoln. Because we wanted it, I mean, originally it was going to include that first block, or basically the properties adjoining Lincoln Street. And it would still make sense. You know, I'm not sure which bits of that are in the business B or in the downtown or what's happened. But I guess we should resurrect the prior discussions, if you can find them in the records.
That could be challenging.
Well.
Is Jesse here for that?
No. I think we're going back maybe 7 years. I came in 2009, and it went to town meeting. The Smart Growth District went to town meeting that November.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so
September 1st, so.
Yeah, it goes back at least a couple of years before that.
Yeah. There should be minutes.
Yeah.
We can certainly find those.
I don't think it matters, really. We'll just start the discussion over. I think now everybody has an idea of what we told them back then, that if we didn't include these large properties, you'd get uncontrolled development.
Right.
That's why we wanted High. We wanted High Street and we wanted Lincoln Street at the depot. Really
right.
Not much more beyond that because of those properties.
Mm-hmm.
What was the rationale for creating the lines behind the properties and not including Woburn Street? Because people have said, well, gee, Woburn Street would be great to include that. I assume with the residents on Woburn
Historic
Street?
Properties, there's a lot of historic properties across the street.
Yeah.
The problem is that the consultant they hired to come in and start showing some of these things came in with a maxed out development, made everything
right.
Look like downtown Boston.
Yeah.
They just built every building up to the maximum you could do.
Yeah, and that
and
scared
freaked everybody out,
yeah.
Which is true. I mean,
in using, back then, using sort of rudimentary, at the time it was
yeah.
not, it, now it looks rudimentary, but a little SketchUp model
yeah.
mm-hmm.
of, you know, looking down Main Street and everywhere. So it was just
well,
massive.
Well,
so it made it.
Well, they showed a view from the depot looking up Haven Street with three and a half story at the sidewalk line the whole way.
Well, the and at the time, right, what we just talked about is perfect example of why that was so wrong, what they did, because what they did was develop based on, from zoning, what you could build as a footprint. But you can't do that because you need to add parking in. And so parking, even on the site we just talked about, parking controls.
Mm-hmm.
The amount of parking, the location of parking, sharing of parking,
controls, at least in this town, in this town, controls how much things can develop. So they produced all of these massing of buildings that can never happen unless we build, you know.
Unless you can rent them for $1,100 bucks a month as apartments with no parking provided.
Yeah, so it was just sort of set the tone.
You know, you can probably fill as many $1,000 a month apartments as you can possibly build, but you can't have parking or anything like that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of unrelated but somewhat related topic. You know, if you look at our commercial zoning districts, right, we have it downtown and then we have it coming down Main Street, and then there's this intentionally residential district, and then South Main Street commercial again. And from sort of my understanding, that was intentional so that the commercial development wouldn't push out. There was some historic houses like the one we just, or buildings like the one we just talked about. But it seems to me that that stretch is getting pushed out regardless of zoning. And it's not really high quality housing, and it's not high quality anything because it's zoned residential, but it can't be it's not investable residential, but yet someone can't build it for commercial because it's zoned residential. So I guess my thought is that by creating that residential, keeping that residentially zoned little spot on Main Street, we've kind of created this no man's land that's really probably not great for the residents there, and it's not great for the town, for Main Street. Like an odd thing. A decision was made at one point based on something, and it seems sort of like it may be something worth revisiting.
I'm not sure that it was a lot of a decision. It was just sort of a what is. And we've got the A40 chunk on the east side of South Main. And then we've got, there's probably four derelict properties in there, like right next to Dynamic Sports. I mean, they're basically derelict. I mean, and there's a couple of down. One of them, which was, I guess, a commercial reuse. But I mean, there's property there which are technically residential. You know, it's still business A. You know, the business A is not interrupted. It's just that the current use is residential. And there's the three or four properties, I've forgotten exactly how many, between Summer Ave and the JK Market thing.
Yeah.
And that's more or less the only viable non-commercial, you know, that and the A40.
So I only bring that up in turn because we're talking about sort of random lines that seem to have been drawn at one point that may not make sense anymore. And as we talk about economic development, like we did last time, that there seems to be something maybe there's a little stretch there that I think our town policy is creating a not highest and best use.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that's something. That's a hard one to tackle.
Yeah.
Because it's flat out rezoning.
Taking people's land and saying, we're changing this.
But it may provide them with benefits.
Maybe it could
higher value, rezoned. You know, higher value opportunities for them. Too.
Or maybe it's an overlay district.
Yeah.
Or it's like more flexible, so it won't just make all the existing uses non-conforming. It'll allow for a variety of different things.
Yeah. So something to think on.
Anything else?
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
So do I shut this down or just shut it? I don't know, like he showed.
Yeah.
We need to do.
I normally do the.